And we'll get started. So the goal for today's class is twofold. The first is I want to talk about a very important result, sensitivity theorem. This is very much related to some of the research work I do in markets. So that's why I feel that it's an important topic. For those of you who may be working in markets in the future. Markets as in doing research on markets, coming up with pricing strategies and stuff. So one is sensitivity theorem and the second one is Fritz John necessary condition. So this is an alternative to KKT condition. So these are the two topics we will talk about. So in the previous lecture, we talked about KKT condition for inequality constraint problem. So let me just recall what that condition was, what that theorem was. So if X star is a local minimum and regular, X star is a regular point, then there exist Lagrange multipliers lambda star mu star such that the first derivative of Lagrangian at the optimal point is equal to zero. This is derivative with respect to X. Needless to say, h of x star will be equal to zero and g of x star would be less than equal to zero. And then mu j star has to be non-negative for all j. So the Lagrange multipliers corresponding to inequality constraints are always going to be non-negative. And then mu j star is equal to zero for all non-active constraints. So if a particular constraint is non-active, then the corresponding Lagrange multiplier must be zero. And then this is the second order necessary condition, which says that d transpose second derivative of Lagrangian d is greater than or equal to zero for all d in the first order feasible variations at x star. Okay, so this is what we did. This is the KKT theorem for problems with inequality constraints. So today, I'm first going to introduce the sufficient condition. So necessary condition is already done in the previous class. So let's look at the sufficient condition today. So let x bar, lambda bar, mu bar be such that I want the first derivative to be equal to zero. I want the equality constraints to be met at x bar. I want the inequality constraints to be met at x bar. I want my mu j bar to be greater than or equal to zero for all j. Then x bar is strict local minimum.
So condition 3 and 5, aren't they the same? Oh, no, no, no. Okay.
Well, no, they are not actually. Oh, sorry. No, this should be not in AX.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks for pointing this out. So everything looks very similar to the KKT theorem case. So this was the first order necessary condition in KKT theorem. This was the second condition of KKT theorem. This was the third condition of KKT theorem. Like always, whenever we have greater than equal to zero in the necessary condition, we have a strict inequality in the sufficient condition for all D not equal to zero. So this is again similar to the KKT theorem. This is the only new thing that we have in this particular sufficient condition, which is if your constraint is active, then your corresponding Lagrange multiplier must be greater than zero. So this is only for the inequality constraint. So if an inequality constraint is active at x bar, then the corresponding Lagrange multiplier must be greater than zero. So if all these conditions are satisfied, then we are guaranteed that x bar is a strict local minimum for the problem, for the constrained optimization problem. Okay. So whenever you solve a optimization problem and you want to show that you derive the value of x star, lambda star and mu star using KKT theorem, and then you want to make sure that you can show it's a strict local minimum, then you have to check whether all the sufficient conditions are met or not. And if it is met, then you're good to go. Your x bar is a strict local minimum. So as always, necessary condition means nothing. It's just a candidate for optimal solution, whereas sufficient condition implies, if it satisfies a sufficient condition, then it implies that it is the optimal solution or a locally optimal solution. Okay. So with this, if there are any questions on sufficient condition, you can ask me now, or we'll proceed to sensitivity theorem. Great, so let's talk about sensitivity theorem. So I'm trying to solve this problem, minimize fx such that h of x is equal to u, g of x is less than equal to v, and I'm going to call this optimal value. So this is f of x star. I'm going to call this optimal value as p u v, p as a function of u comma v. Okay. And the goal is, so what would be a natural question to ask in this case? So what have I done? I have perturbed the constraints a little bit. So I started with hx equal to zero, but now I have perturbed it to be hx equal to u. And the same thing, I have perturbed gx to be less than equal to v. So what would be a natural question to ask here? We would like to understand the properties of this p. But what properties of p should we be interested in? What do you guys think? Any thoughts? What should we be interested in?
How is the optimal solution changing by changing the u and v? That's what we want to see.
So I don't think you mean optimal solution. I think you mean optimal value, right?
Optimal value, sorry. Yes.
So how is it changing with respect to U and V, right? So that's a good point. So let's think about it. So P of U comma V, let's assume that P is differentiable. And this is P of 0 comma 0. So this is the optimal value we know. Plus second, the first derivative of P UV multiplied by, P 0, 0 multiplied by U transpose U plus the first derivative of P transpose V, right? Plus some small terms that appear in the Taylor series. So we are interested in knowing how does P change as U and V changes, right? So we want to understand the sensitivity of the optimal value with respect to perturbations in the equality constraint and in the inequality constraint. So in particular, as long as we know these two terms, we can understand the sensitivity of the optimal value with respect to the perturbations, because this term doesn't depend on U and V, but these two terms do. So let's try and figure out what is this gradient of P with respect to U and gradient of P with respect to V is. And the sensitivity theorem is basically going to say, let me write down what the sensitivity theorem is. This is proposition 4.3.3 in the book. So X star of UV, lambda star of UV, and mu star of UV. These are the Lagrange multiplier optimal solution and the Lagrange multiplier pair for this optimization problem. Okay, so I'm going to make the following assumptions. X star 0, 0, of course, it's optimal and regular. The sufficient conditions we just talked about are satisfied. Okay, so we require both the necessary and sufficient conditions to be satisfied for this part. So X star being regular was part of the necessary condition. We didn't make that assumption for the sufficient condition, but we need sufficient conditions to also be satisfied at 0, 0 point. So we are just going to make these two assumptions. Then, the first result is P is differentiable in a neighborhood in a small neighborhood around U equals to 0, V equals to 0. So this NBD means neighborhood. So in a small open set around 0, 0, this optimal value P is going to be differentiable. So that's a result of this theorem. X star 0, 0, of course, X star 0, 0 is the optimal solution. X star, lambda star, mu star are differentiable. So not only P is differentiable, but the Lagrange multipliers are also differentiable. And the most important result okay. So we have three results here. The first is P is differentiable, so we don't actually have to assume differentiability here. That we assumed here, we don't have to assume differentiability. It's actually differentiable given the assumptions are satisfied. The optimal solution is also differentiable with, and the corresponding Lagrange multipliers are also differentiable. And the most important part of sensitivity theorem says that the optimal value, the sensitivity of the optimal value with respect to U is exactly negative of the optimal Lagrange multiplier. And the sensitivity of the optimal value with respect to V is exactly equal to minus the Lagrange multiplier corresponding to the inequality constraints. Okay. So this is the key result of sensitivity theorem. Now, how does that help us in analyzing markets? So one of the fundamental theory in economics is that of competitive markets. And what happens when you have multiple competitors in the same market trying to attract as many customers as they want in order to increase their profits and revenue? They will always charge their customers the marginal cost of producing one unit of product. Okay, so let's say you have there is a big industry which manufactures pen, and the marginal cost of producing one extra pen in that factory is just $1. Then the company, assuming that the company has a lot of competitors in the market, it's going to charge its customer exactly $1 for the pen, as cost of that pen or pen. Of course, in real world, they would charge slightly more. So they will charge probably $1.05 or $1.10 or something like that. But it's close to be the whatever number you see is close to the cost of producing, the marginal cost of producing that good or services. Okay, so think about ride sharing when you take Uber or Lyft or taxi companies. So they are almost charging you the marginal cost of producing that service, which is, you know, moving you from one point to another. And so on. In electricity market that you did, you solved one of the examples in assignment one, where you showed that no, you actually didn't show it, but it turns out that the lambda 1 star and lambda 2 star that you computed in that particular assignment is exactly going to be the price of electricity in that particular market. So in economics, it's of fundamental importance to, if you want to come up with prices for emerging engineering systems, you want to set the prices, assuming that you will be in a competitive setting, you want to set the prices to be equal to the marginal cost imposed by each customer. And so the way we are using it is in charging of electric vehicles. So if you have a bunch of electric vehicles who are connecting themselves to the grid, and one of the questions that we are interested in answering is, depending on the flexibility that the customers have. So let's say you plug in your car at 9 p.m. at night, and you're going to go off to work at 8 a.m. next morning. So you have like a window of 11 hours, and you don't necessarily need to charge your car for 11 hours. So there is some amount of flexibility associated with when to charge your vehicle, electric vehicle. We are using this idea of sensitivity theorem to determine what's the marginal cost imposed by each customer, depending on their flexibility window, and using these Lagrange multipliers to determine what prices that customer needs to pay in that market. So now this is a new emerging market, charging of electric vehicles. It's not an established market yet. And so the question of how should you price electricity for EV charging is an open question. And we are trying to use sensitivity theorem to answer that question. Okay. And this is how sensitivity theorem is typically used. So think about cloud services. It was not common 20 years ago to use cloud services, but now it's pretty common. And the question is, how much should Amazon Web Services charge for you to use their servers for doing some computation? And you know, time and again, the answers would come that they should charge them marginal cost because now there are so many cloud service providers. So they are in a competitive market setting. And therefore, they would always charge the marginal cost of providing the service. So this is how the sensitivity theorem is useful in theoretical computer science, in algorithmic game theory, in markets, auctions, and so on. And we are using it too in the context of EV charging. So any question on this sensitivity theorem? Okay, a lot of commodities that you will be buying on a day-to-day basis, whether it's your water bill or electricity bill or gas bill, in almost all these situations, you're almost paying the marginal cost. You're paying the Lagrange multiplier, or the prices you see in your bills are exactly equal to the Lagrange multiplier corresponding to some constraints and some complicated optimization problem. That's a cool insight you can take out of this particular topic.
On those examples, can you kind of go to the generic formulation of the problem and kind of say like what each variable would be in the case of, pricing, like right. EV charging?
Right.
Like the minimum f of x subject to h of
right.
x.
Right. So in that case, in the EV, so I can talk more about the EV charging problem because we are working on the paper. So this is the minimum cost of supplying electricity. To all customers. Such that supply equals to demand. And so that's the first constraint. The second constraint is flexibility windows of the customers are met. And I think that's pretty much it. So the way we are computing the cost of EV charging is we look at the supply equals to demand constraint. And since your vehicle will be charged over a period of time, so it's not a static problem, it's actually a dynamic problem. So we need to sum the Lagrange multiplier corresponding to this constraint across different time steps to compute the price that each customer needs to pay for charging their vehicle. Now, there are some problems associated with that. So for instance, say my scheduling algorithm, well, I'm going too deep into it. Well, So very quickly, so my scheduling algorithm will perhaps ask your car to charge at a higher cost window, whereas your friend's car would be charged at a lower cost window, but both of you have identical cars and have identical flexibility window. So then it would be unreasonable to say that you will be paying a higher price and your friend will be paying a lower price. It's just unreasonable because you both have identical demand and identical flexibility window. So somehow I need to figure out a way to price such that not only we recoup all the cost of charging the vehicles, but we are also equitable across different customer segments or different EV segments within this big market. And that's the point at which we are sort of stuck at this moment, and we are trying to figure out different ways of overcoming this difficulty. Do you see the problem with this?
Yeah.
You see the pricing strategy and the problem with this pricing strategy and...
Yeah. So in this case, what would U and V be?
So the U would be this part. So supply. So remember, suppose one extra person comes to charge their vehicle. So then the demand gets, so this is supply minus demand equals to U. And this is the demand generated by one extra person in the market. Like, let's say you plug in your car. U is equal to how much you have demanded as electricity for your vehicle.
Okay,
so that's the perturbation part. So how much are you as an individual, how much are you perturbing the market by? That's you, and then the flexibility window would be the V part, which is how is your flexibility different from other people's flexibility in the market? So that will be the perturbation in the flexibility that you are imposing on the market. Okay.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah. Cool. So let's move on to the next topic, which is Fritz John necessary condition. And remember, so why do we need a new necessary condition for optimality? So the reason is that in the KKD theorem, we required X star to be regular. Okay, so let me write in KKD theorem. We required X star to be regular. And I don't want to have any regularity assumption. Let's say my X star is not regular. Then what kind of necessary condition would X star satisfy? So X star is optimal. It's a local minimum, but it's not regular. So that is addressed by Fritz John necessary condition. I think somewhere around 1948, so it's less than 100 years old theorem. So X star is optimal. Then there exist mu zero star all the way up to mu r star, lambda one star, to lambda m star, such that okay, so you see that there is a new Lagrange multiplier like term mu zero star in this case, which gets multiplied to the gradient of F. Okay, so there is a fourth condition, which is somewhat technical. But I want to discuss the first three conditions before we move on to the fourth condition. Okay, so X star is optimal. There is no regularity assumption here. Then I have a bunch of Lagrange multipliers such that now we have a new Lagrange multiplier mu zero star, which gets multiplied to the gradient of F evaluated at X star. Okay, so the rest of the term is exactly similar to the KKT condition, but now that we have a mu zero star that gets multiplied by the gradient of F. Then mu j star, including j equals to zero, is non-negative. And mu zero star all the way up to lambda m star cannot all be equal to zero, which means that there has to be some of them that are non-zero. You can't just take everything to be equal to zero, because then equation one will be trivially satisfied because all the multipliers are equal to zero. So the third condition prohibits that situation and says that, well, some of them can be zero, it's fine, but all of them cannot be zero together simultaneously. So that's the third condition. Now let's look at what the fourth condition is. In every neighborhood of X star, so neighborhood N of X star, let me use this cursive N, of X star, there exist X in N such that, so I look at the neighborhood of X star, I look at an open ball around X star, I can find a point X within that open ball such that A, if lambda I star is not equal to zero, then lambda I star HI X star is greater than zero. Oh, not X star, HI X. Okay, so let's look at a picture. This is my HX equals to zero. This is my GX equals to zero. This is the region where we are optimizing this function. So this is GX less than equal to zero. region, and this is hx equal to 0. So you are on this surface, but you are away from this gx equal to 0 surface. Okay, so these things are all part of the constraint set. So even this boundary is part of the constraint set. And let's say let's say this is my x star. This point here is my x star. So it lies on the surface hx equal to 0, but it also lies on the surface where gx is equal to 0. Okay. So the first three conditions are okay. It's easy to understand, but the fourth one is slightly more complicated. So let's look at this condition closely. So I pick a neighborhood of x star. Okay. So I pick an open ball around x star. This is my open ball. So it's going into the original space. It's going into Rn. So it's not just restricting itself to the surfaces. It's going in the entire Rn. And now I look at this open ball. I can find a point x within this open ball. So let's say my point x is here, such that assuming my Lagrange multipliers are non-zero, then lambda I star at hi of x, so multiplication of the Lagrange multiplier times hi of x is positive, and multiplication of Lagrange multiplier multiplied by gj of x is also positive. Okay, so at the same point, this is the point, and at this point, both these conditions are satisfied. And since lambda star and mu star is non-zero, the value at this x, fx, is strictly less than f of x star. So this point satisfies all three ABC conditions. Okay, and this is true for every neighborhood N. Every open ball around X star, you can find such a point X where these three conditions would be satisfied. And that Fritz-John necessary condition. This is, of course, slightly more complicated and kind of not so useful in comparison to KKT condition. But it's also one of the necessary conditions for optimality that doesn't require regularity.
So you mentioned this X doesn't necessarily have to be in the constraint set.
No, it doesn't have to be in the constraint set. It just has to be in the open ball. So X is in the open ball N. Okay. Now, of course, what we are going to do in the next class is we'll start talking about different types of algorithms for solving constraint optimization problems. And we will see that Fritz-John condition is not very useful in those situations in order to come up with algorithms, because these conditions are very difficult to ascertain algorithmically. So that's why Fritz-John condition, although it's a necessary condition for optimality and it is more general than KKD condition because it doesn't require regularity, it's not very useful for algorithmic implementation. So we are going to use KKD theorem and we are going to come up with algorithms that attempts to solve KKD theorem and thereby giving us a candidate for optimal solution. And we'll be discussing a whole bunch of algorithms in the subsequent classes. So from now until maybe 2 weeks, we will just be discussing different types of algorithms for solving the KKT theorem result. Okay. Any questions so far? So this is the sensitivity theorem. So we talked about sensitivity theorem and we talked about Fritz-John necessary condition for optimality. And if you look at the book, we are talking about chapter 4 of the third edition of nonlinear programming. So in this book, chapter 4 is just dedicated to different necessary and sufficient conditions for optimality. under convex cost, non-convex cost, you know, different types of flips on necessary conditions and so on. So we're not going to cover a lot of them. We covered the penalty approach for showing Lagrange multiplier theorem. We covered KKT theorem. We covered sensitivity theorem. And we covered Fritsch on necessary conditions for optimality. So those are the only topics we will cover in that chapter. And now we will move on to chapter 5 of the third edition, which is chapter 4 of the older edition, where we talk about algorithms for solving constrained optimization problem. So since we have a few minutes, let me just broadly tell you what those algorithms would try to do. So the first class of algorithms we will try to solve is, I want to minimize fx, x in some convex set capital X such that g of x is less than or equal to 0. Okay, so just inequality constraint problems over convex set. Then we will talk about minimizing fx, x in x such that h of x equals to 0. Okay, so equality constraint problems over convex sets. And for this, we will talk about interior point methods. And for this, we will talk about augmented Lagrangian method. Okay, so those are the two classes of algorithms we will roughly talk about. So the interior point method, the idea is that let's say you have a boundary and you want to be within the boundary. So this is your gx equals to 0. And you are doing a minimization inside this set. What you would do in the interior point method is you would create a barrier as you get closer and closer to the boundary. So you come up with some function of x that blows up close to the boundary. So the function would look something like this. And such a function would be called a barrier function. Okay, so the way the algorithm works is within this larger optimization problem, we have a smaller optimization problem that needs to be solved. And what is the smaller optimization problem? Well, I'm going to create a barrier around the boundary so that if I am standing at some point xk, the next iterate would try to optimize some combination, some linear combination of this function f of x that I want to minimize and the barrier function, which will make sure that I don't go outside the boundary, outside the set. So, and then I will move to xk plus one. Let me use a different color. So you're standing at xk and you will go to xk plus one. Then you will go to xk plus two and so on. That's how your iterations would proceed by solving the optimization problem inside this larger optimization algorithm. And this is known as interior point method because you are going to go from the interior of the set to the optimal solution. So your path, your entire path will be in the interior of the set. It will never be at the boundary, because of the fact that you have a barrier function that blows up to infinity at the boundary. So that would be interior point method. In the augmented Lagrangian method, what we will do is we will try to find x star and lambda star such that the first derivative of x star and lambda star is zero. And here LC of x star and lambda star is defined as, x comma lambda is defined as f of x plus lambda transpose h of x plus c over 2 norm of hx square. So this is known as augmented Lagrangian. Oh, and also h of x star equal to zero. Okay, so these are the two algorithmic tricks to solve constraint optimization problem. Of course, we are not looking at problems where you have both equality and inequality constraints. And we'll see some clever ways of either incorporating equality constraints in this set capital X or including inequality constraints in this set capital X. So that way we can solve problems with both equality and inequality constraints. And we'll talk about other algorithms where both equality and inequality constraints are explicitly used to solve the problem. But these are the two broad methods, one in which you use barrier function and move through the interior of the set to the optimal solution. And the second approach is to try and solve the, try and get to a point x star such that h of x star is equal to zero. And then the gradient of augmented Lagrangian at x star comma lambda star is equal to zero, where the augmented Lagrangian is, this is the usual Lagrangian plus this extra term, which is the augmented Lagrangian term. And that's what we are trying to solve in the augmented Lagrangian method. So we'll talk about these two methods in the subsequent classes. Any question on these methods? Have any of you heard about the interior point methods before? No? I'm guessing when you looked at the linprog function of MATLAB, it gave you some different options of simplex method or interior point method. So you definitely would have seen it in the help file for linprog in MATLAB. And that's exactly what we will be talking about in the subsequent classes. So simplex method is, by the way, the manifold suboptimization method is the simplex method, which you were asked to code in your previous assignment. And for those of you who came in late, the my code for solving manifold suboptimization is on Carmen. So you can take a look at it. And the interior point method is the other method for solving linear programming problem, which we will talk about in the next class. So that's all I have for today's lecture. We'll talk again on Friday, and I'll go over interior point methods in that class. If you have any question on assignment or anything else, you can stay back. And if you want to leave, you can feel free to leave.
Professor, I have a question about the midterm.
Yes.
It will be on October 16th.
That's right.
And it will cover what section?
So it will cover everything we have done until, Monday we didn't have a lecture, but I sent you so it will cover everything until KKT theorem. So until what we did last Friday.
Thank you.
Yeah. And did you see the assignment, not the assignment, solution using KKT theorem to an optimization problem I posted? No, I didn't post it, but I sent it out via email on Monday. Did you see that?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's also part of the midterm.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so there are no further questions.
Professor,
go ahead.
So I'm just curious to know in the manifold sub-optimization coding, in the last part, we are made to check our code with linprog and then compute this maximum difference.
Right.
According to you, what would you say is a reasonable difference?
Probably 10 raised to minus 3 or 10 raised to minus 2 would be a good difference.
Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Great. See you guys on Friday.
Professor.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
We'll maybe stop recording first.
Okay. Let me